you hear me? Hello? Yes? Yeah? Okay. Thank you everyone for coming. Good evening. My name is Cara Bell, and I am the chairman of Young Americans for Freedom here at UW-Madison. Thank you for coming out and showing interest towards our chapter's largest event yet. Before I have Mr. Shapiro speak, I would like to explain what exactly Young Americans for Freedom is and what we do as a chapter. First, Young Americans for Freedom is Young Americans Foundation chapter affiliate on college and high school campuses across the country. We promote principles of limited government, individual freedom, free enterprise, strong national defense, and traditional values. To do this, we host and participate in a wide variety of campus initiatives, such as the 9/11 Never Forget Project, No More Shay Day, Freedom Week, and the GPA Redistribution Contest, just to name a few. We also host prominent conservative speakers, as you can see tonight. As a principal outreach organization of the conservative movement, the Young Americas Foundation introduces thousands of American youth to the principles mentioned previously. They provide incredible conferences, seminars, educational materials, internships, and speakers to the Young Americans for Freedom chapters across the country. I encourage you to check out our table after the event to learn more about our chapter on campus. All right, now the time you all have been waiting for. Ben Shapiro Show, a nationally syndicated columnist since the age of 17, a graduate of UCLA and Harvard Law School, and the host of The Morning Answer on KLRA 870 in Los Angeles and KTIE 590 in Orange County. Mr. Shapiro is definitely a notable conservative commentator. Oh, but there's more. He is the author of multiple books, including the New York Times bestseller, Bullies, How the Left's Culture of Fear and Intimidation Silences America, and his most recent, True Allegiance. He has led the fight against boycott, divestment, and sanctions against Israel on America's campuses, and speaks strongly towards the importance of free speech on campus. Glenn Beck calls him a warrior for conservatism against those who use fear and intimidation to stifle honest debate. I've never known him to back down from a fight. Sarah Palin says that Americans should consider Ben's advice about how we must stand up and push back twice as hard against this bullying. Sean Hannity says to join Ben Shapiro and fight back against liberal bullying. On behalf of Young America's Foundation and the Wendy P. McCaw Freedom Lecture Series, please join me in welcoming Mr. Ben Shapiro.
Doesn't actually try to arrest me when I come. So first of all, thanks to Young America's Foundation, thanks to the students at UW-Madison YAF for their courage in sponsoring this event. And before I begin, I did come bearing gifts for the social justice warriors in the room. I hear you started wearing these safety pins around because you want to show your fellow college students how you're not one of these awful, terrible Trump people and that you're sensitive and that you want to signal your virtue. So I brought along these safety pins just for you. And I also brought along something for you to wear them with, this diaper. It's time to stop being self-indulgent children. It's time. The folks, in case you hadn't noticed, the folks with the swastikas aren't too nice to my type. Stop being self-indulgent children. Stop pretending that everybody who voted for Trump is a vicious racist. It's your right to protest, of course, but you just make yourself look like an idiot when you cry over a duly held election. By the way, I didn't vote for Trump. You can keep whining about reality like privileged snowflakes, but you're gonna melt in the sun of reality. And by the way, Donald Trump doesn't care whether you protest. Donald Trump is sitting somewhere in Trump Tower eating a steak and bathing in your salty, salty tears. He didn't care. Now, I hear that a lot of folks at this university, publicly funded university, want this campus to become a sanctuary campus for illegal immigrants. I do have a quick question. If this campus can be a sanctuary for people in the country illegally, why are so many people trying to ban American citizens from this community from coming to this lecture? That was an actual thing today. There was an attempt to try to stop members from the general community from coming to this lecture. And by the way, I'm fully aware of this private Facebook page titled F White Supremacy Interrupting Ben Shapiro. Well, with all due respect, F you right back, gang. By the way, just for the record, according to the Anti-Defamation League, I was the number one journalistic target of white supremacists this year. It's been a weird year for me. On the one hand, I've been targeted by Black Lives Matter and called the KKK. On the other hand, I've been called Black Lives Matter by David Duke, so it's been really weird. Thanks, by the way, to a Wisconsin State Senator Dewey Strobel. He wrote today, as a taxpayer-funded university, Madison should make efforts to have more events open to the public, not fewer. But for those leftists who want to make this a sanctuary campus, what if I just declare everybody who's my fan illegal and then they can come whenever they want? Okay, now on to some more important matters. Today we're going to debunk three favorite terms of the left. These are so...
Shame!
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 Wow, it's like Game of Thrones. Should I get undressed and walk down the aisle? I do love it. Hey guys, how's it going? Are you done yet, or you want to like? You can keep standing. People behind you can't see. Like, I'm happy to talk with you.
Safety!
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 Did somebody fart?
Safety!
Okay, so do we have that out of the way, or are you going to continue doing this? Like, really? I tell you, try not to be children, and the first thing you do is start screaming like my two-year-old. I tell you not to be children, the first thing you do is stand up and start screaming like my two-year-old. And by the way, you see, this is how conservatives actually treat people. You stand up, and you interrupt, and you shout safety, and you're perfectly safe. Look at that. It's amazing. Look how that works. And for the record, you should also clarify your chants. If you're going to shout safety, you should at least clarify who farted first. Okay, so we're going to talk about three terms that the left likes to sling around with abandon. These are social justice, white privilege, and safe spaces. Now, I understand this may make some people a little upset. It's okay, you'll live. You really will. It'll be okay. We're all here for you. We'll take care of you. We'll make sure that we pat you on the head and make you feel all better afterward. And honestly, facts don't care about your feelings. And okay, so first of all, honest to God. Okay, guys, I'm sorry, I have to explain to you how semantics work. Like, really, I think this is important now. Okay. You're so boring. You're so boring. Okay, so let me explain to you something, okay? If you're gonna pick a chant, if you're gonna pick a chant like shame. Who, me? If you're gonna pick a chant like shame, watch Game of Thrones first. The bad guys shout shame. You're not changing anybody's mind. All you're showing everybody is that your collective IQ, if it were channeled into electricity, might be able to toast a piece of bread lightly. Okay, so can we talk now, or are you going to keep shouting? Like, really, now's your chance to get it out. Let's hear your feeling. Come on. Just go for it. Or is it going to be like every 30 seconds? Like the annoying microwave timer. Like, you got anything more? You got anything more? Okay. Are we done? Thank you. All right. Social justice. Now, normally I don't like to do this, but if we have any peace officers, this actually is now a disturbance that we would like to get past so that we can actually have a discussion. If you guys want to talk, we can talk. If you want to shout, get the hell out. For God's sake, at least wait till I say something that offends you before being offended. So, social justice is an oxymoron, okay? If a guilty man is acquitted because he's the right race, that is anti-justice. If an innocent man is convicted because he's the wrong race, that's anti-justice. Social justice, however, suggests that your group identity, your identity as a person, relieves you of individual responsibility to be a decent human being. So you get to interrupt lectures if you're the right race or if you're the right gender or the right sexual orientation. You get to do these things without punishment because, after all, that's in the nature of social justice, group justice. We don't hold you responsible for your individual actions. You get extra points in heaven because you were born with a certain skin color or sexual orientation. Today, all you hardcore leftists call yourselves social justice warriors, and you do this because you believe that individual justice is racist and sexist and bigoted and homophobic. Individual justice suggests that we each be held responsible for our actions, but SJWs think that's unfair because we're not just individuals, of course, we're members of groups. What if the groups are disproportionately poor? What if they're disproportionately in jail? How can we achieve group justice if individual justice keeps getting in the way? Right, if it turns out that certain groups have more members in jail, disproportionately, that must be because something deeply wrong has happened, something the system is rigged against that group. It can't be because a lot of individuals within that particular group have committed crimes. Now, the problem with this logic is it sounds sort of bad. If you think of people only in terms of their racial or ethnic groups or their sexual orientation, that's sort of racist, it's sort of homophobic, it's actually sort of discriminatory. You're not any better a person for being black or gay or Jewish. Race doesn't mean anything. Social group is only important if the social group is propagating good things. If you just arbitrarily group people about skin color, that's just called tribalism. Racial diversity doesn't actually mean anything. See, that's what a decent, hardworking person sounds like, as opposed to a loser student here on the public dime, presumably. This is a public university. Everybody here is presumably on the public dime. Okay, so racial diversity doesn't mean anything. Decency means everything. Diversity isn't good unless the people who are racially diverse are doing good things. Diversity isn't bad unless the people doing bad things are racially diverse. Diversity isn't our strength. Decency is our strength. Decency, remember that?
Shame.
Decency.
Shame.
Decency.
Shame.
Decency.
Shame.
Decency.
Shame.
Decency.
Shame.
Decency.
Shame.
Decency. All right, guys. But as you can tell, the left does not care about decency. They care about groups. Why? Because the left doesn't believe in individuals. Instead, they believe that individual rights get in the way of creating their collectivist utopia. They think fairness can only be achieved for everyone if all groups end up in the same place. They want fairness. Not fairness of opportunity or fairness of rights, fairness of outcome. Cosmic justice. Now, individual fairness of outcome cannot be achieved by government interventions, and SJWs know this. So instead, they suggest that the reason that individuals aren't achieving individual fairness is because of collective unfairness, right? Victim groups have been sinned against. The real reason that some groups are less successful in America than others, or some individuals are less successful than others, that's because of white privilege, right? According to the left, if there is inequality of outcome, that's because there's shadowy white privilege. It's living in the shadows, quashing people of other colors. White privilege is inherent in everything, from capitalism to free speech. Any system that doesn't result in racially diverse results, that must be the result of white privilege. So we have to tear down white privilege. And this is a really seductive idea. The campus left simply gives people this feeling of virtue by counting them members of victimized identity groups. If you're an underachieving black woman, the left says you're underachieving not because of the decisions that you've made, but because the system hates you. If you're an underachieving gay Hispanic man, you must be failing because the system targets people like you. According to the campus left, the only people who certainly have not been victimized are, of course, white, heterosexual, cisgender males. Right? The system was built to benefit them. The founding fathers designed a governmental, economic system to protect their own interests at the expense of minorities everywhere. This white privilege, say all these members of the campus left, extends to every area of American life. It's totally inescapable. You're born into it if you're white. You're born with a heavy burden on your back that can never, ever be alleviated if you're born non-white or non-straight or non-male. Now, there is good news for those of us who are white, heterosexual, cisgender males. There is a way to relieve ourselves of this burden. All we have to do is shout shame at ourselves. Right? If we shout shame at ourselves and we acknowledge that the system is privileged in our favor, then everything's cool again. All we have to do is just get up and say mea culpa, mea culpa, mea maxima culpa. It's all our fault.
Shame!
Now, before we go any further, decency. Sorry. Okay, if you guys are all gonna come up here, can we at least have circle time or something?
So,
are you guys having a tough time seeing? Go to school.
Thank you.
Sorry, I just have one question. Do you know me? Do I know you? Like, how do you know anything about me? Why am I a white supremacist? Because you guys are here shouting down people who are speaking. Really? Okay, last time.
How what starts?
What are you talking about? What is it? And why, if you have a question, why don't you just ask it? I'm happy to talk with you, but this is nonsensical. This doesn't help. What was that? Well, then tell your people to sit down. We're having a question-answer period. Well, then who are they? If you want to have a conversation, just have a conversation. This is not productive. This is whiny nonsense.
On this.
You guys are awesome. I appreciate your patience. Just so you all know how this was working. Okay, the reason that those people were not arrested is that the administration decided, full transparency, because I like transparency, that if they called the cops and arrested those students, they would have shut down the entire event. So that's what the administration decided. Instead, they just sort of asked them, and they said, you can have your time at the front of the stage. All I can wonder is if the administration would allow the same sort of privilege for any sort of conservative who decided to do this at a lefty event. And let me just say, this nonsense about white supremacy, it is the vilest form of bullshit racism to suggest that all white people who disagree with you are racist. Okay, now, when last we left our story, we were talking, man, doesn't the school give homework, or does anybody have a job around here? I mean, I guess when you're majoring in gender and diversity studies, you got a lot of time on your hands. All right, so to get back to where we were, we were talking about white privilege and the left's view that that America is inherently racist. All of you are racist, as you saw, and we know because people tell you that you're racist, right? They don't know you. They don't know anything about you. One of the gals over here, I turned off the mic so you couldn't hear the conversation. I said to her, she's the one who's shouting that you're all white supremacists. I said, you don't know me. You don't know anything about me. How do you know I'm a white supremacist? And she said, well, that's the image you give off. And I said, really? Was it the yarmulke that did it for you? Now, before we talk about, the left's argument is basically that inequality between groups is inequity. If there's any sort of inequality between racial groups, that's because something has happened in the United States that is deeply unfair and is currently happening. Not just has happened in the past, but it's happening right now. We are all the beneficiaries of white privilege. We are all the purveyors and propagators, words they don't understand, of white privilege, right? Now, it is true, before we go any further, that black people in the United States have obviously suffered historic discrimination. Right? It's inarguably true. Of course that's true. It's even true that some people are likely suffering from the effects of historic discrimination under things like Jim Crow. But that does not mean that black people right now are suffering from institutional discrimination. And historic discrimination does not explain current levels of inequality. It certainly doesn't justify discrimination against white people who had nothing whatsoever to do with Jim Crow. Individuals all over America experience inequality. Some of us are born rich, some of us are born poor, some of us are born smart, some of us are born protesters. Right? Nobody is capable of righting wrongs done to people three generations ago by penalizing their great-grandchildren. You can't do that. The solution to historic injustice is not modern injustice. Three generations ago, my people were being slaughtered by the millions in Europe, and FDR wouldn't let Jews into the country. That doesn't mean there's widespread anti-Jewish privilege throughout America that requires restitution from all of you. That's not how this works. We cannot fix where you started in life. We can't. That's beyond your control. That's beyond my control. But the notion of white privilege suggests you can never, under any circumstances, overcome where you started in life. Because there's this big bear called white privilege that's trying to eat you. That if you make it, even if you make all the right decisions, white privilege will stand in your way. That is a lie, but it is a lie that this campus obviously promotes. In 2013, the History Department created mandatory diversity training, giving out handouts on the re-education process, which sounds kind of Orwellian, needed for white people to overcome racist conditioning. This university has sponsored a multitude of events on white privilege and supported the lying Black Lives Matter movement. New freshmen are supposed to take diversity training where they learn, of course, about white privilege. As Katrina Morrison, a junior from Milwaukee, said last year, quote, we wanted to talk about privilege. What is white privilege? What are the sets of privileges that we all have? It's okay that we have these different sets of privileges and identities and can still coexist. The new Our Wisconsin training program, which was initiated for the freshmen this year, it's gonna cost about $200,000. And it includes students taking part in discussion groups, writing about their experiences, and practicing other mental exercises to help them realize their feelings toward other ethnicities. As you can see, this has been a wild success. In general, it turns out there's another reason that in a free country, some people fail and some people succeed. Some values, some behavior is better than other values and behavior. And people who tend to hold fast to better values do better than people who don't. Perhaps equality of opportunity only exists so long as people are willing to take advantage of those opportunities. And that's the truth. White privilege isn't reality. It's just a cowardly way to blame somebody else for your own failures to live up to decent standards. Whites are not born with a genetic predisposition to doing the right thing in some arbitrary moral system that benefits whites for doing the right thing. There are three simple life rules that will guarantee that you are not permanently poor in the United States, regardless of race, regardless of gender. Finish high school, get a job, get married before you have babies. That's it. And I guarantee you that everybody in this room and all the people outside are capable of this. Right, you've already finished high school. Everybody, even the poli-sci majors, will eventually get a job. And you're all capable of not having babies before you get married. Just don't put that there right now without that thing on it. Come on. There is no such thing as generalized white privilege or institutional racism. There is just decision privilege. For example, it turns out that the greatest privilege in American society is being born with two parents in the home. And that is true for every single race. It is true regardless of race. The poverty rate among two-parent black families in the United States is 7%. The poverty rate among white single-parent families is 22%. What happened to the white privilege? Why isn't the white single mother richer than the black two-parent family? Well, because single mothers are not richer than two-parent families. End of story. The single greatest predictor of intergenerational poverty in America is single motherhood. White privilege is not responsible for elevated levels of black men getting black women pregnant and leaving. Okay, it is not. And white privilege, by the way, is also not responsible for an increasing number of white men getting white women pregnant and then leaving. There's no white person holding a gun to some dude's head, telling him, screw your girlfriend and take off. It's not happening, okay? How about, here's another privilege. Okay, people are always whining about the white privilege in the criminal justice system. Here's another privilege that I think is more important. It's what I like to call the not committing crimes privilege. Okay, the higher criminality rate in the black community is not the result of some evil white system of skin privilege. It's because individuals are committing crimes. If you don't want to go to jail for murder, I have an easy solution. Don't murder people. Here is the fact about that supposedly evil criminal justice system. It actually under-prosecutes murder in minority communities. You know why? Because minority communities are under-policed. When police do come into contact with black people to take the lying, disgusting Black Lives Matter movement's cause, police are less likely to kill black people than white people in the same circumstances. As early as 1994, the DOJ surveyed felony cases in the country's 75 largest urban areas. You know what they found? Lower felony prosecutions for blacks than whites. A Deadly Force Lab study from Washington State University last year found that participants were biased in favor of black suspects in simulated threat scenarios. In 2015, the DOJ investigated the Philly Police Department for racism. You know what they found? They found white police officers were less likely than black or Hispanic police officers to shoot black suspects. Just a few months ago, front page of the New York Times, study from Harvard University, Professor Roland Fryer, he surveyed 1,000 police shootings. He found black suspects are shot less often than white suspects in comparable situation. By the way, Fryer is black. In 2015, the cops shot, here's the total statistic, you ready? In 2015, the cops shot 987 people who died. A huge majority of those were armed or threatening deadly force. Blacks represented 26% of those shot. Blacks also represent in the United States nearly 50% of all murder perpetrators. Police officers are 18.5 times more likely to be shot by a black male than an unarmed black male is to be killed by the cops. How about the white privilege of stop and frisk? We hear this one all the time, right? The white stop and frisk is super duper racist. Mayor de Blasio, that idiot communist from New York, he thinks that. In New York, the reason why stop and frisk keeps running into minorities is because minorities keep committing crimes. Between January and June 2008, 98% of all gun assailants in the city of New York were black or Hispanic. Stop and frisk targeted 85% black and Hispanic. So statistically, they were discriminating against white people, actually. Right? If there is white privilege, it's in over-policing white communities and under-policing minority communities. Black areas plagued by violent crime don't need fewer cops, they need more cops. And they won't get them, thanks to people like those Black Lives Matter protesters. And more black people will die because of that. How about pulling people over for speeding? Right? They keep saying it, driving while black, this is the idea. Only one problem. So for example, the DOJ thought that the New Jersey State Police, the troopies in New Jersey, they thought that they were pulling over black people at elevated rates. So they did a study. This is back in 94 under Bill Clinton's DOJ. And what they found was that black people sped disproportionately. Blacks were 25% of all speeders and 23% of drivers stopped for speeding. How about sentencing disparities? You hear this one too, right? I'm just going through and debunking all of your sociology classes now, okay? How about sentencing disparities? They're always talking about the difference between crack cocaine and powder cocaine. You know why there's a difference in sentencing between crack cocaine and powder cocaine? The reason is because black legislators from the inner city were sick of watching crack ravage their communities. They wanted more penalties and higher penalties to get the drug dealers out of their communities because crack is more addictive and easier to distribute than powder cocaine. If you actually want a comparable substance, take the sentence for crystal meth. Crystal meth has exactly the same sentence for a possession of 1 ounce, and virtually all the people who are arrested for possession of crystal meth are white. But all of this is white privilege, right? It's all white, everything is white privilege. When Baltimore riots, when a majority black city riots after a majority black police force is involved in the death of a black man, and the city has a majority black city council and an entirely democratic city council, and there's a black district attorney, and a black mayor, and a black attorney general, and a black president of the United States, the riots are because of white privilege. And that's how this works. And if we're going to talk about privilege, you know, according to the left, the idea is that if there's a group that's doing well in the United States, it's because of privilege. Let's talk about the really privileged people in America, the people who are certainly suffering from systemic privilege, who are really benefiting, I should say. And this, of course, is the nefarious Asians, right? Those nefarious Asians, those terrible, terrible Asians, right? Asian people do better in terms of, on a general score scale, they do better on standardized tests to get into college. A Princeton University study showed back when the SATs were out of 1,600, blacks were receiving a bonus of 230 points on the SATs at Ivy Leagues versus their competitors. Asians were being penalized 50 points, which makes perfect sense and is totally fair because the country was built to benefit Asian people. Right? We have to punish the Asian people because the system was built to benefit them, obviously. I mean, come on. This is why the Constitution was written by Asian founders in Korean. Now, as you may notice, if you accuse a racial group of privilege without evidence, it looks an awful lot like horrible racism, doesn't it? But that's what the left does constantly, and that's what we just saw tonight, when every white person in the audience was labeled a white supremacist and a beneficiary of white privilege without one single solitary shred of evidence. It turns out there's no such thing as white privilege. Fact-based perspectives are not a privilege. Values are not a privilege. White privilege is just a way to tell you that if you're a white person, you need to shut up. That's all that white privilege is. Okay, so if we can't actually achieve equality of outcome, according to the left, then we need to do something else. We need to make everybody feel equal. We'll have to have, our feelings have to be, we have to feel warm and fuzzy inside. It's so important. All these people here have to feel so special. They have to come down and stand here until they feel like their mommies love them more. They have to be down here feeling good about themselves. Their hearts must warm at the feelings that they feel. We all have to feel great about ourselves. We all have to feel like precious, wonderful snowflakes. And that means trigger warnings. We have to warn people when we're about to trigger them. Unless, of course, you're on the left. Then you can trigger away, right? You can threaten people with violence. You can disturb lectures. You can do whatever the hell you want. Earlier this year, there's a black student here. His name was Denzel McDonald, and he was arrested. He's arrested for graffitiing messages on campus, including F the police, the devil is a white man, spelled I-Z. I don't know if they teach spelling at this university. And white supremacy is a disease. McDonald was charged with 11 preliminary counts of vandalism, one for disorderly conduct, for allegedly threatening to murder someone who witnessed him doing the graffiti. So, were there massive protests against McDonald? Nope. The Afro-American Studies Department sent a letter to the students explaining, quote, "What so many of you are experiencing isn't a sign of individual weakness. It's a version of post-traumatic stress syndrome, a mental health crisis as serious as those following campus shootings or natural disasters." Why? Because the cops came in the room to arrest the guy. A letter signed by 700 students and faculty, written by Dr. Johanna Almiron, who has a future doing other useless things, whined about the evil police arresting McDonald in class. She called it an ambush, and she explained, quote, "The way UWPD officers enter my class was very aggressive, with bulletproof vests and guns visible. Oh no! I cannot believe they humiliated and terrified my students." Okay, really? Like, we have a bunch of people in this room, including a military member in the audience, a lot of people in this room, both the guys. Both the wonderful fellas who provide security for me have gone to war in both Afghanistan and Iraq. All I can say, And all I can say is that if you're in a classroom and cops come to arrest a graffiti artist who threatens somebody with murder, and you're very offended by the sight of the gun, you are just a giant pansy. By the way, after all of this, there was another campus protest. You guys are good at that here, apparently. It was titled, We Are God, which is weird. God doesn't know about it. It says, We Are God, a day of disrupting white supremacy and anti-black racism at UW-Madison. Remember, all of this was about a black guy graffitiing, F the police, and the devil is a white man, and then being arrested. Right? That it's white supremacy to arrest that guy. The protesters said they wanted to let the chancellor know that there are consequences for perpetuating white supremacy. And after all this is totally legit because they were microaggressed, right? They were microaggressed. That's the other big word on campus these days, microaggressions. We have to be careful that we should never say anything that people can even construe as offensive. Right? It doesn't actually have to be offensive. They just have to, in their weak little pathetic pea brains, they have to decide that they are offended, and then they have been microaggressed, and then they get to lash out at people, right? That's how microaggressions work. That's the beautiful thing about calling them microaggressions. It's not just you said something that offended me, you have aggressed me. You did something that aggressed me, and the proper response to aggression is aggression. So if I microaggress you, you get to macroaggress me. And some of the things that the left thinks are microaggressions are just insipid. Right? If you say, I'm colorblind, really, on campus now, they consider this a microaggression, which is weird, because I thought that it was bad to see people in terms of their race, but now I'm being informed it's good to see people in terms of their race, unless you're white people, in which case you're racist, right? If you use terms like he and she, this can be perceived as offensive to people who do not consider themselves cisgender. Again, weird, because biology. If you say things like, where are you from? If you say, where are you from? This is considered a microaggression, because if you ask someone where they're from, you're implying they're not from here. Right, because I assume you weren't born, like, right here. Like, on this spot, I assume you weren't born. Like, where are you from? Okay, so, if you say anything remotely factual, that's a microaggression, too, and you get to shut down events and be an idiot. Okay, so, at this campus, obviously, new freshmen have to be educated about diversity. Joshua Moon Johnson is the special assistant to Vice Provost for Student Life. He said, quote, college is often the first time where people are exposed to people who are different from themselves. Those could be religious differences, racial, socioeconomic status, sexual orientation. Many of the incidents reported to the team involved disrespectful speech that was intended to be funny or inquisitive. Okay, so maybe you shouldn't be that offended. Maybe you should just say that was a bad joke. Or maybe you should just leave. Wow. Okay. But Johnson says that students have to be taught the historical context surrounding race, difference, and violence. Unless, of course, you're a white person, then screw you. The training includes talks about identity, culture, and microaggressions. Johnson, by the way, said that his particular set of work is influenced by his personal identity as a Christian, queer, multiracial, Asian-American, Euro-American man who grew up in Mississippi, which is a lot of labels. And the nice thing is that the more labels you grant yourself, the more ways you can be offended, which means the bigger a hero you are to people on the left. At UW-Milwaukee, one group actually asked people to stop using terms like lame, trash, and politically correct. If you use lame, trash, or politically correct, these are microaggressions. Mike Sportiello, who's the head of student government and a future lame, politically correct trash collector, he said that the campaign was designed to talk about how you feel. Life is about looking at how everyone feels and interacting with each other, and then presumably if you don't feel good, you hit somebody, right? And this has bled up, unfortunately, to broader swaths of the left. So I've experienced this personally, and I love telling this story. So who here has ever watched CNN Headline News? Show of hands. Okay, this is the entire crowd that has ever seen CNN Headline News. No one else in America has ever seen it. They don't know it exists, right? So they have no ratings at CNN Headline News. So this would have been about a year ago, and it was when Caitlyn Jenner was in the news, because Caitlyn Jenner is, of course, the great hero of our time. And ESPN had decided to give Caitlyn Jenner the Hero of the Year award. It was very important. Caitlyn Jenner was a great hero because Caitlyn Jenner is a transgender individual. So CNN looked up conservative in the white pages. They actually do this in LA, and I'm the only one there. And so they called me in. I'm the only conservative in a 30-mile radius, and they said, can you come in and talk about this? And I said, sure. And they said, well, you know, they always pre-screen you. They said, what's your perspective on this? I said, well, my perspective is there's nothing heroic about somebody who's suffering from mental illness. And I take mental illness very, very seriously. There are mentally ill people in my family. Pretending that the delusions of mentally ill people are reality and that we all have to conform to those delusions does no service to the mentally ill, and it does no service to the rest of society. Caitlyn Jenner needs help. Caitlyn Jenner does not need to be feted for mutilating his body. Right, this is my perspective on transgenderism. Okay, so they call me in and they say, and they bring me into the green room, and the producer comes up to me and he says, "So we here at CNN Headline News have no ratings." And I said, "Yes, I'm well aware." And he said, "So tonight we really want you to just say what's on your mind, just say what you feel." I said, "You came to the right place." And then he says, "And by the way, I used to produce for Jerry Springer." It was at this point that I should have started having some second thoughts. But since I deal with this stuff on a fairly regular basis, I figured, okay, what's the big deal? So we go into the studio, and they seat me here, and there's, I think, three people who are to the right of me and three people on stage, right? And all of them are of the left. So it's me against six leftists, which makes it almost fair for them. And they start the discussion. And the discussion is, should Caitlyn Jenner be given the honorary Medal of Honor? Should Caitlyn Jenner be given a burial spot at Arlington National Cemetery? Should Caitlyn Jenner be appointed Pope? Should we construct a golden chariot to carry Caitlyn Jenner to the sky like Elijah, right? That was the nature of the conversation. It wasn't, is this heroism? It was, how great is the heroism? Like, more or less than the guys who stormed the beaches in Normandy, right? That was the discussion. And then finally they come to me, and I express the opinion that I just expressed to you. I said, they said, does Caitlyn Jenner deserve the award? And I said, no, I don't think Caitlyn Jenner deserves the award. There's nothing heroic that happened here. And I neglected to mention one thing. The person sitting next to me was a transgender person. The transgender person's name is Zoe Turr. Zoe is formerly Bob, and Zoe had about 100 pounds on me, and his voice is an octave lower than my own. So we're having this discussion, and Zoe, I say what I'm saying, you know, biology matters. There are only two sexes. You don't get to make up in your own mind what your sex is and then tell everybody else to deal with it. I can't call myself Napoleon Bonaparte and expect everybody else to just call me Commander. That's not the way that it works, right? I can, if I had to identify as anything, by the way, I would certainly go with Your Grace. But in any case, this discussion goes on, and the transgender person sitting next to me, Zoe, turns to me and says, "You don't know anything about biology, little boy." And I said, "Well, I know for a fact that every single cell in Caitlyn Jenner's body contains a Y chromosome, except ironically for some of his sperm cells." And Zoe Turr says, "Well, you don't know anything about genetics, little boy." I just keep repeating this over and over. "You don't know anything about genetics, little boy." And finally, I turn to Zoe Turr and I say, "Well, what are your genetics, sir?" And honest to God, I did not actually mean to offend anyone. It's just that where I come from, you call men sir and you call women ma'am. And he is a biological man, whether he thinks so or not. So I said to him, "You know, what are your genetics, sir?" And it was the sir that set him off, obviously. And he reaches, this is on live national television now. He reaches over and he grabs me by the back of the neck on live national TV. And he says, "If you don't cut that out, I'll send you home in an ambulance." And honest to God, my first thought was, that doesn't even make any sense. You don't go home in an ambulance. But what I actually said was, that seems mildly inappropriate for a political conversation. Because normally when I engage in political conversations with people, they don't threaten to do me bodily harm while grasping the back of my neck with their not particularly feminine hands. But here's the punchline of the story. It's not just that I'm a jackass. The punchline of the story is that everybody on the panel, every single person on the panel, nobody has any problem with the assault and battery that just occurred on their set on live TV. Every single person goes, "How could you say that to Zoe? That was just terrible. How could you possibly say that? You knew that was going to offend Zoe." And that's the first time I dropped facts don't care about your feelings. Like, I'm sorry that it offends Zoe Turr that Zoe Turr is a man, but Zoe Turr is a man. By the way, the threats of violence continued after this. As Zoe was hulking out of the set, Zoe turned to me and said, "I'll see you in the parking lot." And security actually had to escort me to my car, which is really weird. That was not how I envisioned my night going. And then later that night on Twitter, Zoe Turr threatened to curb stomp me, all of which I thought was deeply unladylike behavior. But of course, all of this is okay according to the left, because nobody bothers to ask whether microaggressions are free speech. It doesn't matter to folks on the left. Instead, they simply have to be quashed, right? That's totalitarianism, using force of the gun to silence people who disagree with you. And the folks on the left control the campus dialogue, because if you call yourself a victim, that makes you the good guy. You can do anything to the person who's the bad guy. There's a woman, I guess, named Nika Akubizi. I don't want to get her name wrong. She's executive director of United Council of UW Students, Inc. And she said this year, she said, maybe I can't pay attention in class because someone calls me the N-word on my way to school, which is terrible, obviously. Microaggressions happen continually. So any effort to decrease those, increase opportunity for students of color, women, queer folks to have space that is not oppressive to learn in. I don't think limiting microaggressions is limiting free speech. Yes, it is, by definition. You're free to say whatever you want in the United States of America and nobody gets hit. This is the first principle of Western civilization. But don't worry, they're not for limiting free speech or anything, right? I mean, these people down here, they weren't limiting free speech. And once you've done all this, you've created a safe space. That's the beautiful thing. Now you finally have a magical safe space where everyone can feel equal, right? Except for the people who can't speak. Those people just shut up. They don't have to feel equal. But the rest of these people, they can all feel really safe. And they shout things like safety. Now, I was just here. Were there any threats of violence against the people shouting safety like scared little girls? No, there were no threats of violence. In fact, people were urging them. Why don't you tell us what you want so you can get the hell out of here? Right? No, that's not how, but according to them, it is inherently unsafe for people to disagree with you. It is inherently unsafe for people to disagree with you under any circumstances whatsoever. And now, of course, we have to host safe spaces for everybody. So if somebody wears a stupid costume to a UW football game, right, then we have to hold a safe space for that, right? This happened like a couple of weeks ago here. You had to hold a safe space because somebody wore a costume to the football game that was a jailbird costume. On one side was Hillary Clinton's face, on the other side was Obama's face, and then somebody dressed up as Trump and a rope around the neck. Okay, it wasn't a lynching thing. It was leading around a prisoner. But, and by the way, it wasn't a lynching thing also because Hillary Clinton is a white woman. But it doesn't matter. Everything has to be construed in the worst possible light, even stupid costumes. And then we have to have safe spaces. So you have somebody like Ruth McAfee, who's Assistant Dean of Diversity, Inclusion, and Uselessness. And she writes, it pains me to be sending out yet another email advertising a safe space hosted by the Multicultural Graduate Network and the Black Graduate and Professional Studies Association because, in theory, students should feel safe in any space on this campus. In wake of the recent events that have occurred, they're offering a safe space for grad students hurt by this to come and relax, vent, and or just enjoy one another's company. First of all, I'm just going to argue with this. When LaRuth McAfee says it pains her to send out yet another email advertising a safe space, it does not pain her. That's literally why she gets paid. If there were no safe spaces, she would be out of a job. They need to create need for safe spaces, otherwise administrators get fired. Right? But the left won't ever say grow up to anybody unless you're on the right. Unless you're on the right. So the same administration that declared a safe space because of a costume says it's okay for one of its students to sell hoodies that say all white people are racist. The same student also marketed hoodies reading, quote, if I encounter another cop with a God complex, I'm going to have to show the world that they are human. And the administration has nothing to say about that. UW said, in this case, the individuals involved are exercising their rights to free speech and engaging in a private activity unrelated to their status as student. Ah, I get it. So now free speech is okay. Now free speech is okay. How convenient for everybody. I mean, again, I love the administration's decision here to suggest that if we have to sit around waiting for these idiots to leave for 20 minutes because if the police have to arrest anybody, they have to shut down the entire event. Right, so I can't speak and you can't listen if idiots get arrested, which makes perfect sense, except for not. Okay, safe spaces are safe in the same way that the Matrix is safe. It's nice and safe until you wake up and you realize that you're actually in a bucket of goo and there's a wire strapped into your head. As you can tell from our guests earlier, all of this is making college students totally insane. It's making them whiny, crybaby, insane people. And it makes them evil too. Because if you're constantly on the lookout to be a victim and you think you can act with violence to people who victimize you, you're going to end up hurting other people. You will. You will end up doing bad things and hurting other people. It is important that we all get out of this victim group mentality and fight that mentality at every turn. Here's the truth. America is the safe space. And nobody cares enough to victimize you. No one cares about you. Your parents do. My kids care about me. My wife cares about me. My parents care about me. Nobody else cares about me. Great. I don't want people bothering me. I don't want people telling me things I can't do. The more, you may have noticed this from leftist government, the more people say they care about you, the more they want to bother you. Okay, but in America, nobody cares about you. It's your job to make your way in the world, and nobody is going to get in your way because they don't spend every waking moment thinking about how to keep you down. They have other things to do. They have jobs. They have lives. They have children. They have wives. They have husbands. They have lovers. I mean, they have everything going on in their own life. They don't have time to worry about the whiny snowflake who's here on a state subsidy tuition. They don't. So the idea that you need a safe space from all these people, they don't care enough about you to worry about how to stop you. And that's the wonderful thing about America. And that's why we have to fight for every shred of freedom that we can keep. We have to fight every shred of political correctness. We have to stop this nonsense, because the more of this fascistic nonsense there is, the more talk about social justice and white privilege and safe spaces and trigger warnings and microaggressions, the more of this nonsense there is, the less freedom there will be. And if we don't maintain that freedom, there will be no safe space for anyone. And we, all the people in this room now, all the people who are hearing my words, we are the dividing line between freedom and tyranny. Well, Ronald Reagan once said that freedom was always one generation away from extinction. Well, freedom is also always one generation away from revitalization. And we can be that generation if we stand up and stand together and stand for freedom. Thanks so much. Happy to take your questions.
All right. Thank you.
Sure.
All right. We will now open this time up for questions. I ask that you please keep your questions very short and specific, rather than giving a long narrative before asking your question. This ensures efficiency of the time we have available so that multiple questions can be asked. We will stop taking questions at 9 o'clock. If you have a question, please form a single file line on this by Harry. And remain silent until it is your turn to ask the question. Thank you.
Ready? Absolutely, of course. So, let's get started. And we'll try to run through the questions relatively quickly because I know people have a lot of questions.
Hi, Mr. Shapiro. So, I believe that the first half of the 21st century will be controlled by identity politics. I think the trend is clear considering we had the first women and orange man win party nominations. I want to know how a person who may not rely on identity politics can effectively make their voice heard over those who do.
Okay, so this is a really great question. I agree that what we've seen is the rise of identity politics on the left, and I think that there's actually a rise of identity politics on the right. It's why you see the rise of the so-called alt-right, which is an identity politics-driven group, the idea that white people need their own sort of political action group. And that's a problem to me. I'm not somebody who believes in identity politics. I think identity politics are actually evil. I don't think that you have your own interest group because of your race or your skin color or your ethnicity or any of that. So the only way to really speak to this is by going back to a message that I think we all chanted tonight, which is decency, right? It's very easy to get tribal. People are inherently tribal. We all feel more for our families, as I said, than we do for people more broadly around us. The only way that you break that cycle is by having what they call social capital. And the way that social capital is created, the reason that I trust you or that I trust my neighbor to babysit my kids is because I know that my neighbor is a decent person. So if we encourage everyone on an individual level to abide by decency, then you can break the never-ending cycle of identity politics. But that actually requires stuff to happen outside the realm of politics. It requires an upsurge in civic morality. It requires an upsurge in things like people going to church and joining together as communities. It requires a real move toward people talking about how to deal with each other morally on a non-governmental level. If you do all that, you can recreate a social fabric that has been torn apart by identity politics. Thanks a lot.
Hey, Ben, huge fan. First of all, my question for you is pretty simple, and that is the Republican Party the answer for conservatism in America?
So the Republican Party is just a tool, and as we've seen in this election cycle, it's a tool that's available for anyone to take over, right? So sometimes you're going to get a conservative leading the Republican Party, and sometimes you're going to get an ad hoc nationalist populist leading the Republican Party. It's the obligation of people who are conservative like me to try and fight inside the Republican Party to change the leadership if you don't like the leadership. And you know, talk of third parties, very difficult structurally to put together a third party. If Trump ends up driving the Republican Party far away from conservatism in a very clear and obvious way, you will see some rumblings about a third party, because there are too many people who still believe in kind of root traditional conservatism to be thrown off by Trumpism. So is it the tool right now? Will it always be the tool? Not necessarily. The Whig Party was once the tool, presumably, and that fell away too. So things change.
Good evening, Mr. Shapiro. I have a question for you as a Harvard Law School graduate.
Sure.
Regarding the incident at Camp Randall, the man was asked to take off the quote-unquote noose around his head. Under the Brandenburg test, is this constitutionally able for the police to ask him to take off this rope, or is it considered free speech?
So, I mean, I assume that it's free speech under, the idea that it's not shouting. First of all, shouting fire in a crowded theater is based on a case that was Schenck, which has been debunked for 60 years. But I'm not sure what the campus regulations are. There are policies that exist on campus that don't exist anywhere else in American life. And the Supreme Court has approved some of those things because there are time and space constraints. But if it's message specific, then you get into trouble. So it's the very least, in my legal opinion, it's constitutionally questionable. That doesn't mean that I think it's a great idea or I think that it's a wonderful exercise of freedom of speech, but it is definitely questionable. Anytime there's a free speech question, I tend to lean on the side of free speech. And by the way, folks, if I'm answering to camera, that's only because there are people who are watching on the live stream, and it looks weird if I'm talking out here. So.
Mr. Shapiro, thank you for taking a principled stance criticizing Trump this election cycle. Thank you for introducing me to Harambe memes. Last week, John Oliver used his show as a call to arms to support Planned Parenthood because Republicans have the House, the Senate, the White House. Do you anticipate pushback within the Republican Party if the pro-life movement tries to move forward with its agenda in the next 2 years?
I mean, this is a really good question. I'm not sure how committed Donald Trump is to, for example, reversing funding for Planned Parenthood, right? He said early in the primaries that he liked Planned Parenthood. He thought that they did some good work. It'll be interesting to see if he clashes with the new Congress over that, because clearly Paul Ryan, a lot of other members of Congress, would like to withdraw federal funding for Planned Parenthood. Obviously, I think that's a good idea. I think abortion is immoral, and the idea that I'm paying for somebody else's baby to be killed seems pretty ridiculous morally, ethically, legally to me. I think all of it's really dubious. It is definitely questionable. As far as John Oliver, we have a really bad habit in this country of taking everybody seriously if they have a British accent. And that seems to me a bad mistake. We ought to judge John Oliver by the content of his speech, not the quality thereof.
We've seen politics become more divisive and messy business, and as a result, arguably the most qualified people aren't running anymore. What would it take for you yourself to run for office? And then, do you think we'll ever get back to a time where those most qualified people want to be in politics and want to?
Well, I mean, there's always been sort of a disconnect between the right and the left in terms of qualified people going into public office. I will get to your first question. There's always been a disconnect because on the left, if you're really smart and qualified, you go into government. And on the right, if you're really smart and qualified, you go create things that help people and make millions of dollars. So what you end up with is this weird disconnect where the people who are on the Republican stage are all of sort of, with a few exceptions, they're all sort of middling IQ and not necessarily the world's greatest and smoothest orators. And on the Democratic side, you have a bunch of people with Ivy League degrees, except for this time around when you have an old crone who was gonna be handed anyway. And also a loonbag old socialist who escaped from the asylum. So this time actually bucks the cycle a little bit. And so we end up with a race between the two least qualified candidates in American history. But all that said, what would it take for qualified people to jump in? First of all, people have to learn to love the fight, especially people of our generation. We have to learn to love the fight. Okay, the fight can be fun. This idea that there was ever civility and gentility in politics, Not really. There was more kind of on an open level. But the fact is that back in 1800, if you read the scurrilous broadsides being published by the Adams campaign against the Jefferson campaign and back and forth, it was pretty rough stuff. I mean, you had a guy named James Callender, who's actually a muckraker for Thomas Jefferson, writing things about how John Adams was senile and he was running around the White House throwing his wig at people. Really. And meanwhile, you know, you had muckrakers for Adams trying to discredit Alexander Hamilton, who was on Jefferson's side, and bringing up all the issues about him having adulterous affairs and all that. So it's always been a rough business. I think that conservatives have to engage in that, and they have to like it. It's why people embrace Trump. It's because Trump actually comes off as aggressive. For all the problems I personally have with Trump morally, ethically, politically, the one thing that Trump is aggressive. And so it's going to take a new generation of aggressive conservatives. As far as would I ever run for office, I mean, honestly, in this day and age, I'm not sure I'm qualified. I'm not the son or the husband of a former president. So it's a pretty restrictive group of people who are allowed in. And I'm also not one of the Trump children, who I guess are next on the list. So I'll have to blame my father if I never run for office. It's his fault.
Thank you, Ben. Huge fan. Would you say it's possible for the left to recognize broken families as one of the biggest problems in American society? And if so, what would it take for the left to realize how big of a problem this is?
Okay, so the left is never going to recognize that broken families are a problem because it is one of the goals of the left to break families. Historically speaking, if you read Marx and Engels, they do not like the traditional family. They think the traditional family is a bulwark against an overarching brutal state. Right, so the idea is, and they want the overarching brutal state, so therefore they don't want the family. The family is a bunch of people who care about each other more than they care about the community at large. And so this is why in Soviet Russia, the chief goal was to separate children from their family, have them turn on their parents. I mean, some of the great Soviet heroes in the Soviet Union were kids who reported their parents to the authorities. Right, so the left has never been in favor of traditional families. They see it as a threat because traditional families don't vote according to how the left wants them to vote. They vote in favor of leave me alone. I've got my family. It's my job to protect them. So the left is never going to stand up in favor of that to the detriment of everybody involved. And therefore, it's incumbent on particularly religious people because religion still has a significant amount of weight in American life, unlike in Europe. It's incumbent on religious people to make sure that their kids understand the value of family. It's incumbent on secular thinkers to make clear to people that broken homes, that single motherhood is not an affirmative good. And when Hollywood tells these lies, a great book by Charles Murray it's called Coming Apart, and it's actually about white poor people, white poverty versus white wealth. And he says one of the problems is a lot of people who exist in the white wealthy sphere, people in Hollywood, they live like traditionally religious people, but they preach like far leftists. So they'll be married, they'll have kids, they'll have the same divorce rate as kind of normal folks, but then they'll preach that all families are created equal. And look, this is not to say there can't be great single moms. There can. It's not to say there can't be crappy two-parent homes. Of course there can. But on a general level, if you are born into a two-parent family, you do have an advantage over people who are born into a one-parent family. It is everybody in this room's responsibility to live out these ideals, teach them to your kids, and teach them to all the people around you, regardless of race. Okay, and I understand there are people, I spoke at a school called Otay Ranch High School in San Diego, and it's a largely low-income minority crowd. I don't know how the public school approved it, but they did. And so I was speaking to them, and at one point I said exactly what I've said here. Single motherhood is a predictor of poverty, and if you're impoverished for all of your adult life in the United States, it's because you're not good with money. It's because you make bad decisions with your money. And the principal actually walked down and shut down the speech and excused the entire class if they wanted to leave, because he said there are too many kids here who are products of single mothers, and they might be offended. Okay, if you can't tell people the truth because they might be offended, we're never going to get anywhere here. So we have to tell people the truth regardless of whether it offends them, because the truth is the only thing that's going to make them more free and more prosperous.
Hi.
Howdy.
Fact number one, transgender is not a disease. This is not my opinion. This is facts from the World Health Organization and the American Psychologists Association. Just like gay people don't have a disease. Fact number two, rich kids stay rich, poor kids stay poor.
It's not true.
Out of 1,800 billionaires in the world, 12 of them are black. Where you come from, where you grow up, how much your parents earn, whether your parents were married plays a major role in determining
where your life will end up.
Fact number three, I would just like to remind you that hate speech is not free speech.
Yes, it is.
And my question is, since facts don't care about your feelings, why did you use false facts?
Okay, so none of the facts that I used are false. First of all, yes. First of all, would you like the answer? Okay, so the three facts you mentioned, you talked about transgenderism. First of all, until 5 minutes ago, the DSM specifically defined transgenderism as a disorder. It defined it as gender identity disorder, now calls it gender dysmorphia, which doesn't even make sense. It says that depression is the actual problem, not the actual gender disorder, which again does not explain why the transgender suicide rate is upward of 40%, and the actual suicide rate for the rest of the American population is lower than 3%. Okay, so that's number one. Number two, you talked about income inequality, and you suggested that all wealth is inherited. This is nonsense. According to the IRS statistics, if you are born into the bottom 20% of wage earners in the United States, you will not be one of the bottom 20% of wage earners in the United States. 90% of people will not be within 15 years. There's tremendous wage mobility in the United States of America. Plus, there is not a group of people who just sit at the very top and stay there. People move up and down, in and out of the 1%. 1% just defines the line of income. It doesn't define the people who are in that 1% of income. I've been in the 1%. I've been out of the 1%. It will happen to lots of people. People who are older tend to be more likely to be in the 1%. They weren't once in the 1%. What happened? Okay, so that's number two. Number three, you say hate speech is not free speech. It depends how you define hate speech. The only speech that is not free speech is speech that overtly defends or pushes violence. Specifically, speech that is generating violence, right? That's the only type of speech that's not hate speech. If I say things you don't like, that's not hate speech. And if you think that it is hate speech, you're a fascist. End of story.
Hey, Ben, big fan. Two things. One, I'd like to call my brother Anders. Hey, Anders. Someone out there watching the live stream. Number two, I debate socialists all the time, and their only real comeback is, oh, that's not real socialism, or that's not real communism. Is there any way to really get around that and try to make them see that, look, just because your version of socialism, that magical fantasy land version of socialism, has not been tried, doesn't mean that socialism is an acceptable concept.
Yes. So the problem is that you're arguing with them in terms of the effectiveness of socialism. So what that argument is, you say socialism doesn't work, it fails everywhere, it makes people poor and miserable, right? That's the argument. And then they go, but that's because it hasn't been properly tried, right? That's their comeback. Here is the actual argument that works with socialism. It is immoral to steal from people, even if you vote to steal from people. Okay, if there are three people in a room, and it's me, and I have $100, and you and your friend are in the room, and you vote to beat me up and take my money, that does not make it morally legitimate for you to beat me up and take my money. One of the great lies that's been told about socialism, and you see this all the time, is people say socialism, beautiful idea in theory, but it doesn't work in practice. No, socialism is a shitty idea in theory, and it's an immoral idea in practice. Okay. Socialism violates at least three of the basic Ten Commandments for those who still care. It makes government into God. It suggests that you can steal from people if you vote for it. And it says that it is good to be covetous of your neighbor's ass. Right? For Bill Clinton, it has a different meaning. But the problem for conservatives is we never actually argue on a moral level. We're constantly arguing on an effective level, on an efficiency level. And that's a problem because the left always argues on the moral level. In the end, they always say, sure, my ideas don't work, but they're fair. They're fair, right? And so what you have to say, the only way to come back to that from that is to say, no, your ideas are not fair. Your ideas are theft. Your ideas are theft. You don't get to steal from other people just because you want their stuff. That's the only way to beat that argument. Do it on the moral level. Otherwise, they can always argue, well, it's not perfect. It's not perfect. Okay, there's no way to come back from that because, again, they're operating in unicorn land with gumdrop rainbows and fairy skies. Thanks.
Hey, Ben, I'm sorry, your grace.
Thank you for not stealing my identity from me.
Yes, of course, I want to be polite here, obviously. Yeah. Anyways,
respect the pronouns.
Juan, how'd you become a Cubs fan, or a White Sox fan? Yeah.
How dare you?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Your grace, please forgive me. Pray for me tonight. Two, could I have the honor, your grace, to shake your hand? And then three, how do we fix the education system in America? Because as you know, the K-12 system is really kind of falling apart in the inner cities. Our model is pretty much outdated. It's something that's been used since the 1920s.
Yeah.
Secondary education is also kind of what, you know, as we just saw from the precious cupcakes outside.
Yeah.
If you major in lesbian dance theory, as you like to say,
yeah,
you get a $200,000 education and you can't get a job.
Right.
What do you think the solution be to that?
Okay, so first of all, on the White Sox question, my dad and mom are from Chicago. My dad was a White Sox fan. I inherited all of his rooting interests, and it's been a really bizarre year for me. I mean, really, between the Cubs winning the World Series and a reality TV show star winning the presidency, it's been interesting. So that is, as far as shake my hand, be happy to do that if security allows it. And as far as the education system, the only answer in the education system is, of course, the same as it is in any other market-based system. You need a market, right? If you grant vouchers, if you grant charter schools, if you pay teachers according to their product, if they perform better, you pay them more. If they don't perform, you fire them. Right? You actually have to have a free market system that involves local control, because in the end, parents are going to be the ones who have to choose the best, what's in the best interest of their child. It's also going to take a bit of civic re-education, because the fact is that this has nothing to do with color. There are lots of miseducated kids in this country because education is not taken seriously in a lot of communities across the country. And so people are going to have to, you know, be told that, and they're going to have to learn that education matters a lot. And you can see this. I mean, in the Jewish community, education's always been a priority, and that's why Jews have always been very highly educated, regardless of the society in which they live. Americans have typically been highly educated, too, because we respect and value education. One of the ways to do that is by giving control back to the parents and making it their responsibility. The more government steps in, the more parents step out. And that's been true in every aspect of the private sector. The more government steps into welfare, the less people give charity. The more the government tries to regulate morality, the less the church does. Right? The fact is that the bigger government is, the less private choice there is. And private choice is the only way of guaranteeing quality of any product. When people declare a right to education, a right means that you have the ability to secure what you're looking for from somebody else, presumably. So if there's a right to education, I can force a teacher to teach my kid for free. There's no right to education. Okay, there's a right to seeking an education. And that's what we ought to focus on, is broadening the options for people who are seeking an education and ensuring that parents do a better job of that. And if parents won't get their kids an education, we have to talk seriously about whether that is misparenting in a severe enough way that you talk about, you know, if the government steps in, if that's child abuse. If you just refuse to educate your child in any way, and if you don't care whether your kid ditches school, is that child abuse? I mean, we do have truancy laws in this country, and kids can't take care of themselves. Thanks.
Hi, Ben. Big fan. Two things. One, we're trending number two on Twitter right now, so that's cool.
That's awesome. All right.
My question...
Sorry, you're going to get the quick handshaker. Come on in. Let's do it real fast. All right, dude.
Thank you. I love you. Big fan. My question is similar to the last one. It's where did this campus fanaticism come from, and how, if ever, does it end?
Okay, so the campus madness came about in the 1960s, and what happened is the same thing that happened to the entire 1960s generation, and that is a lot of people came back from World War II, and they said, we are going to protect our kids from all vicissitudes. We just went through the Great Depression and World War II. We are going to make the world safe for our kids. They're never going to have to experience hardship. And they did a wonderful job of that. They made the most prosperous country in world history, the most peaceful country in world history. And their kids grew up in the lap of luxury. And once you grow up in the lap of luxury, young people particularly are always looking for something to push back against. They're always looking for something to fight. And so they decided they had to fight the system. They had to fight injustices in the system. And some of the injustices they identified were real, like racial injustices or injustices based on sexism. And some of them were absolutely false, like the Vietnam War. Right? So the fact is that they were looking for something to rebel against. And the administrators simply let them have their way. The administrators simply said, OK, we'll cave before you, because obviously, I think they were taken by surprise. And now those administrators have taken over the universities. Right? Now the kids took over the slots that they once occupied. They occupied the buildings. And then they became the professors. And now you have a self-perpetuating cycle, because in order for anybody in this room to get a doctorate in the social sciences, you personally have to go through the rigors of a leftist professor agreeing with your dissertation, right? So if you write a dissertation on why gun control is a failure, good luck trying to get somebody to sponsor that dissertation. So you've created this cycle. The only way to break that cycle is, once again, more options. And that's why I say that, you know, schools like Hillsdale College do a wonderful job, provide a wonderful alternative. The other thing that I say to college students is, in this particular case, you have no choice. And so if you have to play a leftist in order to become a professor, and then you can use your power against the system, do it. Right? So if you have to, when I was at UCLA, I graduated summa cum laude from UCLA and then cum laude from Harvard Law School. I didn't have to do this at Harvard, because Harvard was actually open to this stuff. But at UCLA, I had lots of professors who were very much to the left and made pretty clear that if you disagreed with them, you were going to get graded down. And so I would always speak up in class, because we had blue books. I don't know if you guys still do blue books, but we had blue books, and you wrote your student ID number on it, not your name. So they had no clue who I was, right? So I would talk in class like the Republican conservative that I am, and then in my blue books, I would write like Bernie Sanders. And it worked beautifully. It worked beautifully. Straight A's from UCLA. And now the wonderful thing is they can't ever call me stupid because I have degrees from their top institutions. So that's you know, that's something that you may have to do in a liberal setting if you have no other choice, obviously.
Thank you, Mr. Shapiro, for coming. I've just been informed we are trending number one on Twitter.
Oh, wow, okay.
Yeah. So
nice.
My question...
Thank you to the protesters.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Thank you. If you ever debate Milo Yiannopoulos on campus, I'm sure I'll be rooting for you, and I'm sure we'd all love to see that. The day after election was a national day of mourning across campus. There were chalk drawings galore, you know, as much as they can. And anyone that I've brought up, I sat in the front row here, and I had in my biology lecture that was canceled to talk about our feelings about the election.
Unbelievable.
And one person noticed that I was looking up the Wisconsin, see what happened in Wisconsin after election night, and he said, "You're not going to like the numbers." And I said, "Well, I'm a conservative. I voted for Trump."
Like numbers, yeah.
And he got up and he sat three rows back. No words against me, and then he stood up for 15 minutes talking about his feelings. But I was wondering, how are we able to engage in a conversation where Madison is such an echo chamber for liberalism?
I mean, first of all, not every conversation is engageable, obviously. You can't follow the guy to the back of the room and start talking about why your vote was worthwhile and why it's great that the most corrupt woman ever to attempt to run for the Oval Office doesn't now occupy it. Right. And by the way, again, this is coming from a guy who didn't support Trump in the primaries or the general, right? I didn't vote for Trump or Hillary. Neither of them met my minimum definition of people who deserve to be president. But I am certainly very, very, very pleased that Hillary Clinton is not president of the United States and that Donald Trump apparently vanquished her with a bucket of water. I think that it is worthwhile. I think that it is very much worthwhile to consider in every conversation what's the purpose of the conversation. So I would speak to somebody on the left who wants to have an honest conversation in a different way than I would speak to people who are standing up here shouting at me. If you're standing up here shouting at me, I can't have that conversation. When I'm on my deathbed, hopefully many, many years from now, I'm going to look back and go, God, I really wish I had those 10 minutes back where I was trying to talk to the idiot shouting safety at me. Right? So you have to gauge what's the purpose of the conversation, whether it's worthwhile or not. And then if it is worthwhile, then bring facts and figures and consider whether the other person might have a point, because sometimes the people on the left do have points that you should consider and maybe change your opinion on, maybe not. But you can have open and honest but you have to determine at the beginning what's the purpose of the conversation. When I'm debating somebody, the purpose of the conversation is not for me to convince the person I'm debating, it's to convince the people in the audience, which means I have to destroy the person I'm debating. It is morally incumbent on me to go full Terminator. So, with that guy, you're not going to be able to have a conversation with him. Hopefully, you'll identify people who actually want to have open and honest conversations that are useful.
Thank you.
Absolutely. So much love, guys. This is great.
Thank you, sir.
Hi. I apologize for not knowing who you are, and I'm tired if anybody doesn't know that. Sorry.
Well, thank you for coming, even though you don't know who I was. Did you kind of, stumble in here?
I barely walked in. I was wondering, how old are you?
I'm 32.
Okay. Well, then I am twice the age of most, unless you're over 30 and still in college. I would like to speak to your mama. like I said, I run a food pantry and soup kitchen.
Thank you for doing that.
That's fine. For 11 years. I've noticed that over the years, we have given more than we expect of the people. The people that come to the food pantries and the soup kitchen do not put any time. My volunteers come from all over the place, but they do not come from the people who are using the sector.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any way you think that morally we have changed to not make it? It's never shameful to need help. I mean, I've been married for 35 years.
Yeah.
We've lived in a van. I mean, we've worked our way up to living in a beautiful home. So that's not, I'm not saying
that's great.
That. I'm just saying, when did it become shameful's not the right word.
Yes. No. When did the stigma disappear about without repaying it, taking aid?
Or at least being grateful.
Yeah. Or at least being grateful. Yes. I mean, I honestly think it's when the government got involved. I think when the government decided to replace private people in providing these services, people started to think it's owed to me. Right. This is why these things are now called entitlements. Right. They used to be called they used to be called privileges, or they used to be called benefits, but now they're called entitlements. You are entitled to them by virtue of the fact that you're here. Now, nobody's entitled to use of your food pantry, right? But people see it as an entitlement because they've been taught from the time they're young that in America, you're entitled to certain basic things, and if you don't provide them for yourself, then you'll just go get them somewhere else and never repay it. In Jewish morality, which I rarely cite, but in Jewish morality, there's a basic injunction, and that is every single person has to give charity. Every single person. It doesn't matter how poor you are. Even if you are a poor person, even if you are dead poor, even if you're dead broke, as Hillary Clinton once was, even if you're dead broke, you actually do have to give charity. It's incumbent on you as a human being, not because your charity is actually going to help somebody that much or poor, but because it makes you a better person. Charity is about the giver, not just the recipient. And in America, unfortunately, we've come to the conclusion that charity, welfare, unemployment benefits, all the benefits provided by the government, these benefits are only and solely for the benefit of the person who is taking. They're not for the benefit of the person who is giving as well. And the more government takes, the more it feels like it's not a matter of morality for me to give to poor people. It's a matter of they're going to put me in jail if I don't. And so if there's nobody there with a gun, the social science showed this, by the way, like you read child rearing books, and one of the things that they say is you actually shouldn't give an allowance to kids to do normal chores if you want them to do normal chores, right? If you give them an allowance, they start to think, oh, I'm supposed to be paid to do these things, right? If you actually say to them, no, you're obligated to do these things, and now you get a normal allowance for doing other stuff or just unrelated to these chores, then they'll do the chores with alacrity. In America, we've given that up. In America, we've given up the idea that you are obligated to do certain things as a citizen in a republic because government says we're going to force you to do it or you're going to be punished for doing it. And voluntarism is the name of the game here. And as voluntarism disintegrates, so does the social fabric. You can't trust your neighbor because obviously the only reason your neighbor is being nice to you is because the cops might come if they're not.
Hi, Ben. Sorry that representatives from the People's Republic of Madison treated you with such disrespect.
Oh, but other representatives treated me so well. Thanks, guys.
So yesterday on how Trump's going to pick his cabinet members to The Bachelor, so ultimately...
Because of his tweet. He tweeted out, for those who missed it, Donald Trump, the president-elect of the United States, tweeted out something to the effect of, I am the only one who knows who my final picks will be. Right, and he said who the finalists will be. It was actually the finalists. He said, it's not a mess, it's not chaos. I'm the only one who knows who my finalists will be. And so I tweeted out something like in all capital letters, who will get the rose?
So ultimately my question is, who do you think will be the most qualified and competent people? I know you've been talking about how Bolton would be
fantastic as
qualified choice for Secretary of State.
Yeah.
But for other people, who do you think should get the rose in terms of...
I mean, so he's mentioning some good... So I do, on my podcast, I do a segment called Good Trump, Bad Trump. And I've been doing it for months, and now I get to do it for years on end. And that's the thing with Trump. He's a total mixed bag. Like, you don't know... You put your hand in that bag, and you don't know whether you're going to get a rose or dog do. Like, it could be anything. That's what makes it so spicy. And so, he'll say things like, you know, maybe I'll consider making Rudy Giuliani the Secretary of State. You know, I like Rudy Giuliani, but his experience with international policy is limited to the fact that he lived a few miles from the UN at one point. You know, and then he'll mention Michelle Rhee as Secretary of Education, which would be great, right? Michelle Rhee would be excellent as Secretary of Education. Bolton would be excellent as Secretary of State. He mentioned Kelly Ayotte for Secretary of Defense. She'd be just fine. Right, then sometimes he just mentions like crazy out of the woodwork ideas that I don't understand in the slightest. Right, so we'll have to wait and see. Of course, he only knows the finalists, and the reality show editors have not edited it in the back room yet to make it look like this was all planned. My mom is a reality TV show producer. That's how they do it, gang. So there are some good people that he's discussing. As I've said to others, I didn't vote for Trump. I'm still hoping for the best. He's the president-elect of the United States. I would like to see him do all of the things that conservatives want him to do and keep many of the promises that he made. I'd like him to forget about the ones about universal health care at one point and about tariffs and about wanting to go on a honeymoon with Vladimir Putin. But if he can leave those ones behind, then I would like him to give us a good Supreme Court justice. I would like for him to repeal Obamacare. I would like for him to lower taxes. There are lots of good things he can get done. Unfortunately, we're just going to have to wait and see. This is actually the hard point, right? Once we get to January 20th and he takes over, which, by the way, the sight of Obama having to give up for Trump is just, it's just magnificent. It's just magnificent. And it wouldn't be, I didn't vote for him, and it would be nothing, it's the greatest justice imaginable. For Barack Obama, who thinks he's this great God King wisdom figure, this merger between MLK and Jesus, if you saw the pictures of him with Trump in the Oval Office, it's my favorite picture in human history. It's a picture of Trump, and he's giving the Trump finger to the press, right? And then next to him is Barack Obama sitting straight up, looking into the distance. It looks like he's got a ramrod straight up his ass. And you can almost see the steel behind his eyes, it's that far up. But the capper to the photo, it's the greatest thing in the world. The capper to the photo is in the background on Obama's left, is a bust of Abraham Lincoln going like this. And it's just great because it says everything about this election. But the idea that Obama, who considers himself this wonderful guy, but was really just a celebrity, right? He was just a celebrity reality TV star being faced with the actuality that he's going to be replaced by another reality TV star who he was joking about on Jimmy Kimmel like 3 years ago saying he'll never be president. It's pretty spectacular. So we can at least be entertained. But on January 21st, we'll actually know what this looks like. I'm eager to get there because I want to know whether I was right or wrong about Trump. I hope I was wrong. I was wrong about his electability, obviously. So I hope that I'm also wrong about him as a president. I pray that I'm wrong about him as a president, or it's going to be a long 4 years.
Mr. Shapiro, as you may or may not know, last year, 80 Silicon Valley executives sent a letter to North Carolina expressing their strong discontent for their transgender segregation bathrooms or whatever. Basically, boys go to boys' bathrooms.
Yes.
So for those of us that are going into tech or the private industries, how do we push for a global economy, or I guess at this point, an American economy that's more conservative and actually has the values that we would like to work for?
Yeah, I mean, power and money are the name of the game. And this is why I say you have to make choices, knowing the industry that you're going into, how much you're willing to compromise your own values in order to go into that industry and become successful. You know, I'm lucky enough that I get to be in an industry where my legitimate job is just speaking my mind every day, which is a pretty wonderful thing. But most people don't. I mean, my mom works in Hollywood. That means that she doesn't get to talk politics at the office, and it means that she has to kind of keep her mouth shut when it comes to issues like this. In the end, the people who have the money and the firing power are the ones who are going to be able to determine the future. It's also worthwhile noting, by the way, that conservatives ought to start using their marketing power in the way that the left has used their market power. So the left tries to boycott North Carolina, right, as you mentioned, because they don't like the policy. Well, conservatives should boycott those companies, right? But conservatives should say, well, if you're going to discriminate against North Carolina, we're not shopping with you, right? If you're going to say to Brandon Eich, the CEO of Mozilla Firefox, that he has to be fired because he supports traditional marriage, then we should say, okay, no one's going to download Mozilla Firefox, and you're going to take a hit in your stock price. That's actually happening now with Grubhub, right? The Grubhub CEO said that he was going to discriminate against Trump employees, people who voted for Trump and were employees, and the stock price has dropped like $6 in the last 72 hours. The NFL, I think, is taking a major hit specifically because of this. I think Colin Kaepernick and the Black Lives Matter movement, it's turned off an entire audience. People who used to think, it's a Sunday, I'm just going to turn on the TV and watch a football game, they think, I don't want a lecture on how America's racist and awful, or Bob Costas telling me about gun control, screw it. You know, I'll just watch a rerun of the Dick Van Dyke Show or something. So Americans, conservatives need to start using their power in the market as well.
Hi, Ben. Thank you.
Howdy, you make me feel really underdressed.
I think this ideology of, social justice and victimhood ultimately is Marxism.
Yes.
And as someone who came from Venezuela escaping communism, you can imagine the terror that I feel, when I see the state of the media and academia and given the Democratic nomination, also politics. So my question to you is, why does Marxism refuse to die?
Marxism refuses to die because Marxism gives people a utopia to live for. There's a great book called Secondhand Time that I'm reading right now, which is kind of an oral history of the Soviet Union. It's from all these people it just won the Nobel Prize in Literature in 2015. Great, great book. I highly recommend it. And it's all these people who lived through the Soviet Union and then the fall of the Soviet Union, and all these people who were really excited when the Soviet Union fell, but now it's been replaced by Putin's Russia, and they're nostalgic for the Soviet Union again. They want Stalin back. Stalin shirts are still selling out in Russia, where people's ancestors were being murdered. And there's a book by Daniel Yergin and Joseph Stanislaw called The Commanding Heights. It came out in 1999. And what they said is by the end of the decade of the 90s, capitalism had defeated communism. But they said communism will come back, socialism will come back. And the reason is because in the 1930s, look at the Spanish Civil War, people were dying from the communist side. In the Spanish Civil War, it was communist versus fascist. People on the communist side were dying with the words, this was the rumor anyway, Stalin on their lips. Nobody dies with the words free markets on their lips. Nobody dies with the words nice house on their lips. And the fact is that because American conservatives have not pitched our case in terms of morality and decency and what's right and wrong and what's good and bad, we've instead pitched our case in terms of, look, here's some nice stuff. That's not a winning message. George Orwell wrote a fantastic essay. You should go back and look it up. It's the single best political essay ever written. 1940, he writes about why does Adolf Hitler's Germany rise? Why are young people signing up for Nazism when it clearly is such a flawed philosophy, deeply evil, guaranteeing blood and pain, right? And what he says is, what we here in the West don't understand is that nice houses and decent cars and enough food to eat, all of that's nice enough, but there's still a yearning in the human soul for something more. There's a yearning in the human soul for flag flying, and there's a yearning in the human soul for the sound of guns, right? I mean, there's a yearning in the human soul to fight for something, to make your life matter. Now, as religion declines in the West, and this has been one of the major factors, people don't find their meaning anymore in the idea that I am doing something good on behalf of my fellow man. Instead, they say, I need a utopia to belong to. I need a communal cause to identify with. That's why you see people marching in the streets. That's why you wouldn't see one of these kids who's doing this before stand up and do this by himself, right? You need a bunch of people to do it together. It's important, because now you're part of something larger, and you're brave, and you're special. Right? You wouldn't do it as an individual. As an individual, you could actually have a conversation. But you're virtuous by membership in this clique. So the reason communism will rise again, and is rising again, and Marxism is rising again, is because it says, we're more moral, we will provide a utopia, and you can be part of building that utopia no matter how miserable you are. It doesn't matter if we dragged your parents off and killed them in the gulags. All that matters is that you are part of something great, that you are part of something wonderful, right? And that's not what America is. America says, it's your job to be a wonderful person. It's your job to take care of your family. You want to make America great again, okay? The way to do that is by making yourself and your family great again. The way to do that is by being a decent person, independent of trying to grab the levers of government and use them to shape humanity. That's what the founders thought making America great in the first place was all about. But we have to make that moral argument. We can never stop making that moral argument. And the more we make the argument that our policies just make you richer, people don't care. People don't care, especially in a rich country. In a poor country, people care, right? In a rich country, it's all fun and games, because we can talk until the cows come home about social justice, so long as we get to go home and sleep at night in our nice warm bed sponsored by the state at a top university. But it's a lot harder to talk about social justice when you're eating dogs because you have nothing else to eat, as they are in Venezuela, because all the shelves are empty. Thanks so much.
Ladies and gentlemen, this will be the last question.
Yes, and that transgender that grabbed you by the neck might be a direct result because people didn't listen to me. I'm the only person in 2003 that fought the International Olympic Committee over transgenders. And then it spread to, I sat with Jenner in 1976 before he set the record. And then it spread to the state high school leagues, and obviously it's going to go to the Supreme Court here. You know, the bathroom bill, so I have a long history. I've taken the NBA on, NFL, all the major leagues teams. My question is, where is this all going to end up?
Well, I mean, the left always needs a new civil rights movement, because all of them remember when they were actually in the right on civil rights in the 1960s. So they're constantly comparing everything to civil rights. Right, gay rights are civil rights. Transgender rights are civil rights. It's always the next thing is just like when we were marching on behalf of black folks back in the 1960s. And so after they obliterate gender, obliterate sex as a meaningful distinction, which is obviously silliness. You got the NBA boycotting North Carolina or the NCAA boycotting North Carolina, but they still have separate men's and women's divisions, which is weird. Right? If sex is just arbitrary, then why do you have women's divisions? Why can't it just be a bunch of 6'8" dudes who weigh 300 pounds, you know, banging around in the paint with a bunch of 5'3" women, right? The only way to, I think that the next step for the left, I've always said this, is taking their agenda and destroying the religious right. And so this has always been the purpose of, for example, same-sex marriage. I personally am libertarian on same-sex marriage. I think the government should not be a part of marriage, period. I think the government has nothing to do with it. And that's not because I'm morally for same-sex marriage. I'm not. I don't think that homosexuality is. I'm a religious person. You know, as a religious Jew, I believe there's such thing as sinful and not sinful. That doesn't mean that's public policy, right? Public policy is different than that. So when it comes to public policy, my feeling is that the government is really crappy at everything and hasn't promoted traditional marriage in any real way. When they tried to, it failed. Obviously, the government can't be the barrier between marriage and failure. That just doesn't work. I have, personally, two marriage certificates, right? I have the one from the state that I don't care about, and it got lost sometime, and I don't care. And then there's my Jewish marriage certificate, which is my ketubah, right? And that's the one that I cared about because it's the one that said I could have sex with my wife. So for religious people, by the way, that's how this works. If you go to the state and get your marriage license, that doesn't mean a lot unless you have a pastor, you know, give the go-ahead. So the reality is that the state really has nothing to do with the marital institution. The only reason the state ever got involved was supposedly to promote procreation. The state has failed dramatically. So I want the state out of that entirely. But what the left is going to do is they're going to use the government-imposed same-sex marriage rulings in order to break every church in America. They're going to take schools, religious schools, and they're going to shut them down if they don't respect same-sex marriage. They're going to say if you don't educate your kids about the wonders of same-sex marriage, then you are discriminating against gay people and maybe against your own kid because you never know, they could be gay. Right? They're going to say that every church, every school, every religious institution in America must be discriminated against if they do not participate in whatever the left social agenda of the day is. And that's a much larger battle than all of these secondary silly battles about bathrooms in North Carolina and such. The left is always on attack. And because they're always on attack, it's incumbent on us to always fight back. We can never stop fighting back. And obviously not just fighting back, dismantling the roots of their agenda, exposing them for what they are, a bunch of people who are grasping and ambitious, a philosophy, more than a bunch of people, a philosophy that says your labor is not your own, your time is not your own, your freedom is not your own. Your labor, your time, and your freedom all are all your own. And it is your job to use them to best effect. Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.